Okay, thanks everybody for coming out. It's great to see all these faces here. It's the Sophia Jacob Lecture Series, Season 2, 2013. And just, we have three great presenters that are gonna talk tonight. Just a thing or two before we start. It's really important to us that we keep these lectures free. So all of the artists who present here do it for free. But there is a donation jar at the front. If anybody's able to offer a dollar or two, the cash goes directly to the artist tonight. We're not using it for any kind of Sophia Jacob stuff at all. So also there's some really rad collaborative posters out there that Jordan printed with some images from the artists. You could take one of those home with you. So for the first presentation, we'd like to welcome Elspeth Walker to the stage. Elspeth is an artist and writer visiting us from New York, where she received her MA in solo performance and queer theory from the Gallatin School of NYU. And we're just really excited to have Elspeth here because she's just been involved in so many different ways. In addition to performing and exhibiting her work around New York, Elspeth is the creator of the web-based project Video Drag, which serves as a forum for research in internet video performance and vlogging. Elspeth is also the New York correspondent for the international online art publication Daily Serving, so you guys can read some of her writing and criticism and interpretation there as well. So we're just really excited and looking forward to Elspeth bringing some of her important ideas to the conversation in Baltimore. So without further ado, let's have Elspeth come up.
Hi. So in this talk, I'd like to introduce the Video Drag project that David just mentioned, which is a project that I developed during my master's thesis at NYU. So I want to illustrate the concept of video drag and some of the writing I did there, and then I'm going to extend from there to discuss some new ideas that have kind of become important to me recently. So my work comes out of a foundation in writing for performance, DIY video production, and relational installation artwork. And I'm sort of interested in creating space through performance in a number of ways, whether that space be real or virtual, literal or imaginary. So Video Drag is a website I made to house this writing I did about drag performance and video art. And it's an attempt to consider the two together. It's an online repository, so it's part academic paper and it's part online resource I developed in order to posit sort of a new theory about drag performance and about identity, about sexuality, about the internet, about technologies of the self and the performance of everyday life. So this phrase, the performance of everyday life, is an awareness, or I guess kind of a concept that's fueled a lot of my personal work. And I'm interested in moving away from a static or singular understanding of an identity and maybe towards the concept of a multiplicity of intersecting selves or presentations of identity, with the goal of positing new livable realities out of fantasy and out of playful identity construction. So video drag is a term that I made up in order to discuss what I see as a new kind of drag performance. And this is where amateur performers use the medium of video, of DIY video, to explore their own performance of identity. So it's they're using video as a tool to explore the performance of the self. So I'm specifically talking here about the interface of YouTube. And I really wanted to focus on YouTube simply because it's the largest platform for anyone to upload videos, which brings up important points about accessibility and about the amateur and who is allowed to create content, right? YouTube is great because of the range of material that's able to be uploaded, right? I mean, there's videos of Rihanna, then you can upload like videos of your dog playing. It gets the idea of, people creating video with a lot of capital, people who are celebrities versus these kind of anonymous submissions. So it's blending the boundaries between high and low video art. And these terms artist and terms like performer become these common denotations that can be sort of afforded to anyone who uploads content. And I think this lack of delineation becomes really productive for the creation of community. It sort of widens the pool, right? So the Video Drag Project is fundamentally based on a conception of drag performance that transcends any kind of binary transformation from male to female or female to male, which is like the traditional definition of drag, right? So it's not about changing between two static or traditional conceptions of gender, but it rather provides an alternative or radical redefinition of drag performance as a performance of identity, right? It's expanding this definition in order to include more progressive and more fluid manifestations of persona and of identity. And I would say that drag itself is a process of becoming, right? It's something that's transitory by definition. It's something that's in between that has to do with the liminal process of putting something on the self. And it's imbued in the practices of dressing up, of makeup, of performing and reperforming everyday life. So the goal is to publicize and pursue this kind of new queer space on the internet. And we're investigating these questions like, what is queer space, right? How do we make queer space? How do we perform queer space? Or inevitably, the different ways in which we carve out queer space through our performance. So we're engaging in this kind of radical redefinition while looking back at history and the historical progression of drag as a practice of bending and the realization of artifice. And video drag sort of serves as an example of and a reminder that performance makes the self. So the project discusses what I think of as this sort of sacred rites and rituals that we conduct online. They're both private and shared, right? I want to see queer activity online as radical and maybe a little witchy and a little subaltern, and sort of an acknowledgement that there's something necessarily occult about virtual communication, that we might be able to conjure something in the virtual that takes us beyond ourselves by performing our own self-image. So it's sort of an investigation of what queerness is all about, and it's an effort to motivate and mobilize and sort of make use of the power of queerness. It's about mobilizing the radical, what lies on the outskirts, the debunked, and what's disbelieved. So the argument that I want to make here is that we create queer virtual space through publicizing radical performances of the self. And these performances can translate into techniques of empowerment for everyday life. And that's the most important part to me, is that these performances can actually affect our everyday lives. So there becomes this kind of doubling back, or this sort of circular motion, which is also indicative of this kind of magic circle, right? So we re-perform everyday life on video, and then these performances then transform the everyday in pursuing a kind of radical or fantastic future. So I think drag performance is really important to consider this kind of magic through this lens, because drag becomes a way to isolate and sort of make us question the fact that the way that we read someone's sexuality or gender is often based upon what someone's wearing or how they present, right? Drag is essentially a kind of subversive social performance that can be used to expose the fact that these realities, or what we consider realities of sex and gender identity, are tenuous, they're unfixed, and they're fabricated. So gender and sexuality are not aspects of identity that we can kind of take for granted or sort of comprehensively know, right? Drag thus becomes a productive technique of alienation for the presentation of a cohesive self. And drag illustrates the phenomenon of identity not as inert, but as something that's crafted through repetitive performance. And there becomes there a potential for identity to become unfixed. So Rosalind Krauss defines narcissism as the medium of video art. And she argues that video art is facilitated through the conduit of the artist's compulsive interest in her own self-image. So for Krauss, the body sort of risks becoming enclosed in the system that's created between the two parentheses of the camera and the video monitor, between the reflection of the self that's created by the video image and the self that's performing in real time. But I think that we should re-examine this narcissistic impulse as something that doesn't necessarily have to be insular or selfish in any way, but rather that it can be sort of a generous performance of one's own priority as a subject. And narcissism or obsessive self-interest isn't necessarily indicative of any kind of like closed system, but it can rather become a kind of magic mirror, right? It's something that reflects not the subject exactly, but a shattered subject that's somehow transcendent or which indicates toward the possibility of a different dimension. We're harnessing the potential power in performing for the self and what it means to perform for attention. The project of drag also recalls this kind of narcissism, I think. It's obsessed with appearance, with illusion, with passing, with this process of transformation that I mentioned. Drag is an embrace of the trappings and the affect of the social performance of identity. So through their obsession with the recognition of affect, with the mirror self that's not the self, both the performer on video and the performer in drag establish this kind of uncanny distance between the self and its performance. So both kind of performances effectively twist the self, right? They call its cohesive existence into question. And because both mediums are bound up in the condition of narcissistic self-consciousness, performing one within the other can allow us to navigate expansive pathways of identity performance. So in extending from Donna Haraway, who I love, and her writing about the cyborg, what I'm really talking about when I say video here is this kind of like infectious technology of the virtual, right? A technology that infiltrates the body, that infiltrates the self, and therefore radically upends our conception of what's natural, what's fixed, and what's coherent in terms of the body and its performance and its movement. And I'd like to point out that natural is a relative term that's situated within a distinct cultural context, right? This is a really dangerous word, and I don't think that we can take this word for granted. So the performer on screen becomes this kind of like liminal being or cyborg, right? It exists in the no man's land between human and machine. Biology becomes technological. So at this point in human life, I mean, liveness is never an unmediated nor fully present event. There's always a facet of simultaneity. There's always some kind of feedback or mechanism that's influencing the way we live. You know, technology may be as simple as like taking our vitamins every morning or putting on clothes or being on a computer all day. So Jill Lane argues that even spatiality is socially produced, right? That we can't even take the space that we occupy for granted, and that embodiment itself is an effect that's produced by the processes through which bodies are imagined and constituted. So that's always about this kind of relationality, right? And as the body is effectively like staged within these different environments, we can no longer consider bodies as simply live or mediated. It's this interaction between physical bodies and phantasmic virtual projections online that creates the kind of community through video performance that we're talking about. So we have to think of this stuff in utopic terms, I think, in order to utilize these technologies in the pursuit of progression, right? There are problematic elements about YouTube that we could bring up, definitely, involving access, you know, involving the comment system, the way people comment, the way that videos are viewed, what becomes popular. But I think that these negative aspects exist with kind of any technology, right? As technologies become integrated into the self, it's not possible for them to always be fully positive. So we kind of have to isolate what we can use in the service of queer futurity and create with it and sort of move forward. And I think the same thing goes for mainstream drag, right? We're working out of a technology and a history here that has definitely accumulated some flaws. For instance, we have to talk about moving away from a baseline of drag performance that relies on some kind of impersonation of the feminine, which risks becoming misogynistic or a caricature, and or that might deny gender, you know, though gender may be tenuous and unfixed, that might deny gender as a lived experience, right? You know, gender may not be real, but it may be malleable and fluid, but it's lived and dire and very urgent in a lot of cases. And I think that that's why looking at performances of the self are so important, right? That they're these examples of people playing with agency and playing with urgency and sort of working against these lived experiences that make it so difficult to exist. So drag, especially recently, has begun to fill a kind of pocket within the mainstream. It's begun to be assimilated. I mean, I'm sure we're all going to watch the season premiere of Drag Race tomorrow on Logo, right? I mean, RuPaul's face is on buses like everywhere in New York. She's a major celebrity. And although I think drag performers like RuPaul have done unparalleled work in bringing drag and gender bending and acceptance of gender fluidity to the main stage, we have to be careful about the price we pay for infiltrating the mainstream and for being entertaining, right? we need to be conscious of the ways in which RuPaul's image, for example, has become sanitized enough for television. So it's important, this is a really important point, it's really important to let difference remain different so that it can continue to do productive work and not be subsumed and therefore lost in the interest of the majority, right? So I'd like to show some examples of video drag now. And I'm going to show you two videos. I'm just going to show you a clip of the first one, and then I'm going to show the full second one. And both of these artists are interesting to me because I sort of found them both by accident. And they both seem to have sort of sprung up, like fully formed from the ether of the internet or something, which is one of the most amazing things about YouTube to me, is that these videos sort of have the power to unearth themselves. And there's like really little background information that's available about either of these performances. And that mystery is like really part of the allure for me. They're like these little pockets of weirdness within a lot of quotidian uploads. I mean, like, you know, cat tricks versus like people like showing what they got from like Sephora the last day or whatever. So I'm gonna show this first video to you guys. This is called Belinda. I don't think it's loaded all the way, but we're gonna try it. We might have to reload it. Hold on, let's do this. We'll see how this goes.
Hello, my name is Belinda. How are you? I'm fine. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you've seen me before.
Uh-huh. Hello, my name is Belinda. Who are you? How are you? I'm fine. Oh, are you fine too? Who are you? I don't know. My name is Belinda. How are you? It's nice to meet you. It's my pleasure. Who are you? Who are we? Yeah. I see your face. Yeah, I see your face.
Oh, yeah. I love your face. Yeah, I see your face. Yeah, I see your face. See your face. Yeah, I see your face.
How are you? I'm fine. Nice of you to ask. Yeah, I'm very fine, you know. I've been around. I've been everywhere. Where are you from? What is your name? My name's Linda. Why don't you come over here? I mean, I'm just here, you know. Why don't you come and see what you can get? Yeah, see what you can get from me, because I can get everything.
I haven't got this for free, you know. I paid a lot of money, yeah, maybe again soon. Yeah, I think I need, yeah, what do you think? Say what you think, like this, yeah, it's good, I've been around. You never know my age, I never age because I do this, you lie,
I paid a lot for this, you know, I paid a lot, No, I don't have this anymore, but soon I will get new one, you know, from Brazil, yeah, you've been there, Tell me what you like, I like you, yeah, I like you, Tell me what you like, for me everything's okay, you know, I can fix,
Okay. I might have to reload this one too. Come on. Can't not laugh and watch that at the same time. Okay. Oh, whoa. There we go. Okay, so I managed to find out that Valinda is actually a performer called Yukiro Javarius, who does drag and is sort of a goth slash like Lolita personality living in Tokyo. And the circus artist, I have no idea who this is. And all the videos on their channel are like, they only have like three videos up and they're all like very interesting and bizarre. And the videos on their channel sort of like act as these kind of like portals to like this other world that they've created. So if anyone has more information about this person, I guess I don't really want to know, I guess. But I think I just want to speak briefly. I mean, there's a lot to say about both of these, right? But I just want to talk about them very briefly. that both videos sort of present these created environments that we can see, right? They're these fantasy universes that are only like semi-realized. For instance, Valinda's fantasy exists within the quotidian space of Yukiro's house. I mean, you can see Yukiro's stuff like lying around everywhere. So the seams where the scene is constructed are really clear. And there's nothing that's necessarily like flawless about the presentation. Both videos involve inherent time and dedication to the construction of fantasy. Like, there's a lot of labor involved in this construction, especially in the second video that we can see. So it's not a passive imagining of any kind of futurity, right? It's an actual pocket where someone has physically and mentally and sort of performatively created this, the kind of space that they want to inhabit. And this may not be sustainable in any way. You know, it doesn't have to do with real time. It's sort of transcendent. I'd also like us to notice how many instances of mirrors, of reflections, of echoes, and refractions occur in both videos. So within these fantasy environments, the video screen becomes a kind of mirror that has the power to create the myth of a holistic self and destroy that myth in the same blow. Because both videos present this kind of confusing multiplicity or replication of the same personality, right? You can see this in all the echoing in Valinda and how many iterations of Brittany there are. I'd also like to point out that, I mean, feel free to disagree with me here, but both of these videos, like, I don't think they're very good, right? Or there are parts of both that I don't like or that are sort of alienating to me. But I think that this kind of is productive because it allows difference to remain different and also kind of abject even. Both videos sort of take the performance to this limit that like I maybe don't understand or like can't get totally on board with somehow. And they're both like these examples of someone that's absolutely doing their own thing. And for what audience, right? I mean, like, it's hard to speculate who they anticipate like liking this, right? So this motivation to perform comes out of this sort of internalized desire that may very well have little or nothing to do with us. And I think that's really important that these performances or these performers are making work out of this need or this personal desire that has little to do with the viewer and is sort of disconnected from the viewer in this way. It becomes about an intimacy between performer and self. And I think this kind of intimacy between someone and themselves is by definition queer, right? So video drag arises out of the mainstream cultural sphere in these ways and infiltrates the popular with these like little fissures of queerness, right? It alters the archive by presenting pockets of queer futurity within the archive of public feelings, the medium or the structure of the vlog. So just as humans are, as we said, inadvertently compounded by the technology that infects the everyday, video drag is an infiltrated presentation that consistently twists the normative, even as it exists innocuously within its platform. So video drag is a practice of subverting the mainstream from within, of tweaking the foundations from inside the building. So in extending from this idea of an intimacy between the performer and the self, I'd like to posit desire as a motivating force for creating new worlds. Wanting people to look at us is a basic motivation for performance, right? It presents these pockets of fantasy that we talked about. It presents these sort of subjunctive performances of becoming. And the performances that we saw exude these creative expressions of desire, these desires for a fantasy body, for a fantasy personality, for a fantasy persona, the desire to be seen, to be watched, and to be acknowledged. The desire to be liked that motivates the narcissism that we talked about can also be a motivating force for the social empowerment of new identities. It's a force that makes people want to push the boundaries as they attempt to square a desire for a fantasy identity with the possibility of integrating into the social. So Micah Cardenas is a writer and performance artist and activist and hacktivist who performs these queer erotic acts on stage with her partner. And she developed the concept of what she calls transreal. And she describes the prefix trans as sort of ontologically meaning liminal, right? That involves some kind of transgression or sort of becoming at its linguistic root. So Micah notes that it's often impossible to understand the what or the why of our desires, right? And that we must focus instead on how we do things. That there's something ephemeral about desire that that taps into this idea of the creation of sort of an unexplainable space. And it's okay if this space is not fully tangible, right? Or comprehensible even, or realizable or sustainable. Desire is not a comprehensible fiction. And via these technologies, the body itself no longer has to be read as a comprehensible fiction. So to paraphrase Donna Haraway again, we must exhibit pleasure in the confusion of boundaries and responsibility in their construction. So there's this important divide to be made that I want to really touch on here between the safe space of the virtual that these performers are working in versus the dangerous and often annihilating, I feel, reality of everyday life, right? And this difference can't be discounted. But despite this divide, I don't think we should look at video drag as any kind of preparation. I think we've moved beyond the idea of any kind of rehearsal here. So in the space of video drag, rehearsal becomes sort of the performance itself, right? It both motivates and becomes the real as it's performed. So video drag both prepares us for life beyond the screen and taps us into the televisual life that characterizes our reality. So I want to go back to the idea that I don't like parts of the video that I showed, and that looking stupid can often be a product of narcissism, right? This kind of intimacy or maybe like extreme proximity or closeness is necessarily awkward and sometimes even repulsive. So we narcissists sort of always want to look our best, right? I mean, that's like the goal, but instead we often end up looking like losers, which is often facilitated by the kind of taking it too far that we saw in both videos today. So in my own work, I've sort of been working with or manipulating this like stupid or laughable but like really honest image of myself. And this work has been sort of by definition hyper-personal, right? And I think you can make the argument that the videos that we saw today are too. And that this kind of extreme proximity allows us to express something that's fundamental and connective about pain, about love, about emotion, and about experience. And that this kind of expression is how virtual community is able to be formed, right? So as a final note on looking dumb, in making my own work, I always have a problem with feeling like my performances are sort of obsolete the second that they're done. And so I often try to like detach from them as quickly as possible, you know, because I don't want that to be what defines me because it's like too close to me or something. And that's probably why I'm not going to show you any of my work right now, because I'm sort of wary about the extent to which I can control my own image on video. But obviously these performances do define me, right? And I think that this impulse to disengage originates from the fact that the work that we're talking about here is characterized by this over-the-topness, by this extreme intimacy or revelation of personal things. But I don't really like see the point in talking about anything if it's not, you know, extremely emotional and therefore caught up in my own formation of identity. And I think that we should be embarrassed by the work that we do, and that this kind of emotion, this embarrassment, which is really just a realization of how close something is to you, right, can be really productive. Cool detachment can't produce activism. And I think if we're developing a radical pedagogy for how to carve out queer space in real life, then we have to be extremely and brutally real about our own desires and our experiences. So the courage to stick by whatever shit that comes out becomes this really important extension of the performance itself. And that's where I'll end. Thank you. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And, like, because his work is not, like, I mean, you can find it on the internet, but the context is, like, in a gallery.
Right, yeah.
It's, like, looks very similar to this work.
Yeah.
It kind of comes to a similar place. So I guess I was wondering, just if you had any thoughts on that, or, like, the difference between his work and, like, what you're doing, or if there is,
Yeah. Yeah, I think context is really interesting, right? I mean, it's funny because the only time I've ever seen Ryan's work is on the internet, right? I know that it's been in galleries, but I've never like seen it in a gallery, so I don't really know what that experience would be like. But I think that this kind of work and like whether or not you think it's good, right, or not, is like sometimes all about context, right? And the context can definitely change how the work is received. And I think that his work is really similar to this. I don't know if it's productive to like kind of try to draw any distinction between the work that he's doing and this work. I think it's all part of the same conversation, right? Of people sort of like working out how to like film these digital personalities. Although, I mean, he is a self-proclaimed artist and he has a budget and he has like notoriety now, right? In a way that maybe these anonymous artists like don't yet. But yeah, I think it's all sort of working towards the same goal. Does anyone else have questions? Okay, thanks.